When autumn arrived, the best that could be said of Richard Seabrook's year was that it could have been worse. The flock of 900 ewes, which he's built up from nothing in 25 years as a freelance farm worker, had come through without the afflictions which had set it back in two earlier years, but the crop of lambs in springtime had been smaller than usual, and prices at the summer lamb sales not especially good.
Good. Hey, up.
Now, in September, Richard had come across an area of good grassland available to rent during the winter, and in order to redeem his fortunes, he had taken it on to try an extra short-term venture, fattening lambs for sale in February. The new field was 10 miles from Ickworth Park, where the flock lives, and the lambs, 600 in number, had to be transported, 35 at a time, in his old lorry. Like much that Richard does, the enterprise would be a thin one if he and his partners counted their hours. But they don't. They survive not by costing jobs, but by taking on every reasonable prospect.
There's nothing the sheep likes more than plenty of space. The more space you can give them, the better they thrive. And this is ever so beneficial to bring them right onto a fresh bit of country. This is light land out here. This is sort of light, stony land, completely different to what the park is. That's really good sort of land to run sheep on for the winter time.
Yeah, go on up, Doug.
We have kept on several more store lambs this winter to have something to sell during the winter months besides firewood. These are some lambs, a lot of them, things that we've bought just last week or two. We sold a good old haul of our own lambs early on. They'd have been far too big to bring out here. These little lambs, we hope, will come fat about February time.
Let me come out.
Chloe's going to be very active this morning. Yeah, we'll hope. Righto then, we better, you got some dip?
Yeah.
Well, and get the stuff out.
You carry my two. I'll sit down.
Poor old crew. There's still another little old speckled face from there, what I saw the other morning.
Richard's old dog, Moss, soon weighed up the lie of the new land. But now, at 10, he was approaching the end of his working days. Richard was looking for a young dog, good enough eventually to take his place, and hoping, as he has hoped all his life, to find one that might become a champion at trials. In August, it had been Pip.
I took him out last Saturday and was rather pleased with him. He's only just coming up, he's only just over a year, and we finished the course, and so I'm hoping great things of him in the future. He's ever such a good dog with a big flock of sheep too. He's no end of force, but he's a bit too forceful sometimes, a bit handy with his teeth in close quarters, and he grabbed a ewe the other day, and I thought, right, you beggar, I'll tie you up for that, and I tied him up for the fence, and before I could turn around, he got a hold of my backside, and I flew round at him with my foot and struck my foot up against the post I tied him to, and so he had the last laugh, and everybody else looking on laughed considerably as well.
Come on up, Pip! Come on up! Come on up, Pip! Come on up, Pip!
Pip continued to make more impression with his teeth than with his work, and in September he was superseded.
This little bitch, Meg, here, is my latest in dogs. A lady turned up in the park with her about 3 weeks ago. She bought her, intending to have her as a pet, and that she spent most of her time in the garden sort of hunting the chickens up, and she soon realised she was of a working strain and she wasn't going to be this little house dog and, well, one to take out for walks, I suppose. And she'd heard of me up in the park here with the sheep, and she brought her along for me to give her a try out, and she's been very pleasing. She's a pleasure to take out at the moment, and I hope she'll go on like that.
Meg, alas, didn't go on like that. December.
This pup's a pup that a chap brought down from Scotland. He's the next one I've got great hopes in. School, Kip. Kippy. Of course, he's ever so young. He's about, 12, 14 weeks old now. He shows a rare style and a good eye that everybody looks for in these pups. He doesn't normally get in amongst the sheep. These old ewes aren't just puppy material. They're a bit sort of strong and tend to stamp the feet. They've had three or four crops of lambs and they get a bit strong like that, but he's got a fair bit about him. Hope he doesn't put them out over the electric wire. See, keep the way around the outside of them there just right. That's a rare strong eye he's showing. He keeps on his feet too. He doesn't keep crawling about on the ground too much. I have to leave the string on to get a hold of the little beggar. See, he's going right away, flanking round there. That's good for a pup of that age. This dog's going to be a winner. I tell him every day, this one's going to win the trials one day. I ain't done the good at a trial for years, but probably never shall anymore. I was when I used to do well when I was young and calm, but since we've been involved with all this business side of farming, you completely change your character. See, that pup's gone right away now. Kip, coming up! Everyone I have, I tell my wife, now this one's going to be a winner. You've got to be that with blooming sheep, don't you'd have a life of depression. Kip, coming up, Kip! Here's a good boy. Here's a good Kippy.
That autumn was a milestone in Richard's family life, the marriage of his second daughter.
Between the 5,000.
Well, we need several to get through to finish this lot off for us.
I don't think I just want to do this for a living, really. I've got to push off in the morning again.
Oh,
well,
why's that?
Well, I'm going to take these sheep off the meter for one thing, because they've got to go away because of the car park.
Oh, yes, of course.
Take them to home.
Yeah.
And I suppose I'd have to try and buy some shoes.
Oh, yes, you haven't done that yet.
I bought a pair of shoes for a long while.
Oh, well, that's your usual thing, last minute buy, isn't it?
Perhaps I'll come back in a nice pair of white shoes or something.
I don't think that'd be your style.
See, my flat feet,
exactly.
Wonder?
No, I don't think so.
Keep them nice and clean, wonder?
I should leave that to the bridegroom if I were you.
I, Anne, take you, Rupert.
I, Anne, take you, Rupert.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death us do part.
Till death us do part.
According to God's holy law.
According to God's holy law.
And this is my solemn vow.
And this is my solemn vow.
Never liked singling out one of my flock, but I suppose I really, just on a wedding day, she's bare worth a mention away from the others. And I always refer back to the day when she was expected to be born. This was on a Saturday dinner time, and the wife was getting a bit restless and uneasy. I said, well, you'll have to wait, I said, because we've got some sheep on the field a bit long. All I say to both these people, if Rupert make half as good and nice a man as his father, she'll have a very happy married life. And if you're nearly as good as your dear little old mother, then he equally will have a very happy life.
yesterday was a lovely sort of day for us, really. I enjoyed it to the full so much that I can't hardly talk today, organising people dancing and talking at the reception and things. This is number two married off, and this begins to make you feel perhaps you're getting past the sort of height of your life, really. So I thought the lovely thing about the horse and cart yesterday, that the young farmer said, look, this thing keeps my father alive. He's nearly 90, and these two old horses and this cart are the things that keep him going. And that sort of thing, I think, perhaps it might be sheepdogs and a bit of bell ringing with me right until the later stages of my life.
By December, Richard's extra winter venture of fattening lambs on rented pasture 10 miles from the park was going well. They grazed it in strips, and every morning he or his partner, Ivan Beavis, went up and shifted the electric fence to let the sheep through to a new day's grazing.
Been ever so pleased. In fact, here we are nearly at Christmas and we've sold 200 of them off already without any additional feed at all. All in all, that's been a most pleasing job, most satisfying job. I love coming to sheep every day that are thriving, and you can see how well they're eating it off and how much they love going through the next morning to get this lovely belly full. We always have to come back here about middle day because they get so full, some of them, and in these tractor wheel marks, the way they love to go onto the backs. And of course, if you're not on the spot, you've got a dead sheep. But we've done a firewooden in the woods right next to it, so it all fall into line well this winter time. The wood jobs, that's ever so important to us at the moment, particularly the cash flow it provides through the winter time. In fact, we've been doing wood flat out ever since the shearing finished. We stockpiled no end of cordwood. We look as though we've got enough wood for a lifetime, and here we are at Christmas, pretty well run out of the stuff. I took a load to a man the other day, and he was a bit of a posh-talking bloke. He said, "Now, Mr. Seabrook," he said, "I don't like complaining, but this piece is just slightly too long." He said, "And don't bring me any of those old knotty pieces," he said. "They're not nice to look at." Then, of course, there was the old gal who I'd never been to before, and she said that if I laid the heap of wood in a nice little pile, I was to have a pound for a drink. And so she kept looking at me. She didn't know me. She said, "Oh, so some way off." And she kept looking. And after we'd unloaded, she said, "There's your money for your wood, and there's a pound for a drink." And they still kept talking on. She said, "You ain't the boss, are you?" I said, "Yes." He said, "You give me that pound back. I want that more than what you do." And and of course, I'd done no end of damage with this damned old lorry. I'm not the best of drivers, and I've all broken umpteen manhole covers and electric light, ornamental electric light poles used to be my speciality, and gate posts. And then I jammed a poor old woman's dustbin up against the house once. She said, "Get off the place! Don't come back again!"
More or less up in front.
This is the season of goodwill. I told you I'd bring you a load before Christmas. Thank you very much. Same to you. Cheers, then. Christmas morning is one of the most relaxing days for me of the year. There don't seem to be another soul in the world, and you haven't got to sort of satisfy anybody's wants or anything. You can just creep about round your sheep in your own good time. We don't deliver firewood on Christmas Day. That's about the only day of the year. I generally go home and have this good old dinner, which my wife's an expert at preparing, and I generally clap right out. I know some days after the Christmas dinner I just seem to clear my plate up and put my hands and my head on the table, and I believe I slept with my head on the table for 2 hours on Christmas afternoon. So I'm not very good company on Christmas Day socially, but I love this old go round the sheep Christmas morning. These winter mornings, I'm looking after my daughter's chickens and horse and a few sheep that she sort of got together when she worked at home. She went away to college last September and left me in charge, so I feel that I must do the job just as she done it. And of course, when it's very cold on a morning like this one, I have to take hot water out on her strict instructions. This is a lovely sort of start to the day, really. Whether that's winter or summer, that to go out here after I've had my cup of tea and just feed these things which I'm not really involved with to make money out of or anything, and then you can sort of plan your day while you're feeding them. Of course, these poor old hens never liked the snow. I think possibly these particular ones had never seen any snow before. Some of them come out of one of these battery houses, and they really enjoy this bit of free range down here. But when we had the first snow 2 or 3 days ago, they just looked out, and I had to feed the poor old beggars in the hut. Sheep, of course, most of them sewers bred on the place. There's some of them belong to neighbours which come over here for mating, and then we keep them through the winter a bit. But they're all just sort of sheep that somebody's got a care for, so we must make sure that they have fair dues. Also, I'm strict instructions to do the right thing for the horse, but of course I can't catch the damn thing. Every time I go to put a halter on to lead it into the shed, it just cocks its heels at me and scarpers. But of course when Sue was here, she used to take him in every night and turn him out in the daytime. He's got a good old winter coat on him though. I don't think he's taken any harm. We always feel we're very blessed and lucky to have this house here on 22 acres of ground which belongs to us, that there's no end of people that love their own own little patch to do what they like on. But of course, this isn't a viable farming enterprise. It would be lovely to have a house standing in the middle of a place you could sort of work away at and get your living at. But we must count the blessings that we've been able to develop a sheep flock and that like we have, because the biggest drawback to it all is a heck of a lot of travelling. I suppose most days I must cover with firewood deliveries and tending the sheep all 50 to 100 miles. But if that's all you're going to come up against in life, then I don't consider that's a very big disadvantage.
Long on your horse, all you do is put it in some rock.
This sort of snow business, we do swear about it, but that cleans everywhere up and covers all the ruddy molehills up. That's one thing that does. But we don't mind this so much as we do a heck of a lot of wet. These old sheep can put up with this cold a lot more than what people think they can. They never seem to bother about how cold it is. That's this feeding that's the all-important thing. If you don't keep them stuff full of grub, then you're soon going to land yourself in all sorts of troubles. But if you keep them with a belly full of the right sort of grub, that they can put up with any amount of snow.
The abundant hay crop gathered last July would sustain the flock until the new grass grew and the lambs of another springtime were born. The firewood trade would see Richard and his partners through until the kinder days arrived. All in all, it had been a fair year. In the end, Richard had come through without much profit from his sheep, but without the disasters of earlier years. And for the first time since he became a freelance half a lifetime ago, he had enjoyed the pleasure of having a working companion, Ivan Beavis.
He's a good sort of mate. We make fun of most of our troubles, and he's a heck of a good bloke when we have a breakdown. And of course, he's fairly industrious too. He don't stand about for too long, which is the thing that I like about anybody. My good old faithful dog, of course, is just as good as ever. He's 10 years old now and he never seems to tire. He's as strong as ever. And I've also got heck of a good pup just down from Scotland, and that looks ever so promising, but I expect I'll spoil the chances of that ever running a trial. I generally manage to. Like the wife says, I'm far too aggressive and noisy with women and dogs, I think. I hope one day that we shall have a good, healthy flock of sheep and not a bloomin' lame one amongst them. That's been one of the biggest struggles on this park, is this blasted foot rot job. So before I finally pack up Shepparton, I hope I shall be able to walk amongst them and show them to people without the bloomin' things limping. They seem to say, here come old Seabrook, let's all start limping.
I don't think I shall ever retire as such.
All these old Seabrook relations have been a tough old lot, and I've got an uncle now who still goes to market 3 or 4 days a week, and he's well into his 80s. He don't like to admit it. He says, that ain't old, boy, and you never really want to talk about being old. My grandmother and all the family were rare hard-working people. My grandmother brought up her own brothers and sisters when she was quite a young girl, and she had 14 children of her own, a real hard-working Christian sort of woman, and she was 102 when she died, but this is a good, healthy sort of way of life, and you get a lot of sort of peace of mind and satisfaction out of it.